Hello and welcome to the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. For those that are watching the videos week to week, you'll notice I'm still wearing the same t-shirt because I've done a double recording today. I am joined on this edition by another tag team. It is a returning guest and also someone brand new. We've got the Scotaricans, KJ Mack, come back on the show, and Dave Rivera, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having us, buddy. Thank you for
So
having us.
I'm looking forward to this one because last time I spoke to KJ, it was round about the inception of Scotaricians. So it was quite fresh when we spoke to him back in. Well, episode came out May 2022, so probably would have been April-ish we spoke. So it's good to can we catch up with KJ and also find out a bit more about yourself, Dave, and find out about Scotaricians in general, which is what we're going to do throughout. So I mean, first off, we'll just keep it nice and bright, breezy. How's it going, guys? It's a new year, apparently. It's not before
At
Christmas
this
at
point,
all.
yeah, exactly.
So how's it going?
not bad. It's been good. We're just kind of getting back into the swing of things after I'd come home for the summer, so I went back August, got bogged down with college stuff. I graduated in at the start of December there, so it's now just kind of getting the wheels back in motion. We had a defence during that time, at VPW in Long Island. But apart from that, it was quite quiet for a bit there just because of my college stuff, and now we're kind of getting back into the stride of things.
Yeah, and yourself, Dave.
Yeah, pretty much the same. Just I was waiting, being patient. As far as letting KJ finish all his obligations and stuff like that. I was also focusing on dealing with a few nagging injuries, so it kind of fell in the right time where I can heal some of these injuries while he's getting his situation together. So it kind of worked out for both of us.
Perfect. So, well, not that I'm gonna say, KJ, we've spoke to you before. We will catch up in the last year, but because I don't know a lot about you, Dave, we can dive in a little bit for the standard questions you hear a wrestling podcast of how you got into wrestling. So, how was your fandom begin when it comes to pro wrestling?
Oh man, standard answer, right? It starts back in the 90s, right? I'm a bit older than KJ, so I have some seasoning on me when it comes to like my fandom. Like my first early memories of wrestling was actually watching the 1-2-3 Kid have his match against Razor Ramon at Raw. When I saw that, and just the entertainment aspect, I was hooked. And ever since then, I was just trying to find different types of wrestling. Any chance I got, when my parents would bring me to Blockbuster, I would go and try to find any VHS for those younger ones out there. VHS is a tape. And I would find any VHS of any type of wrestling that was available. And then, just I try to consume as much as I could. As far as like watching, I stopped watching sports. I was just transfixed on wrestling.
I feel good to have you on, Dave, because I'll be honest, I've double recording day. The last guys I spoke to were 21 and 24, and I felt ancient. And as soon as you mentioned VHS, I'm like, oh, thank God, I've got a guy my age. That's great. This is gonna be fun.
On. Are you guys familiar with what Blockbuster is?
We are,
Yeah, we had
yeah.
Blockbuster
All right,
here.
cool. Okay, all right, thank God.
Yeah, I was more of a pick up a VHS at Woolworths kind of guy. That's my kind of age range as well.
Okay.
So I know
So
what
I'm assuming
VHS is.
that's an equivalent to Blockbuster over there.
Much as such, it was the, you got your rental, video rental.
Yeah, no, so I'm
We're
saying
there.
like you would rent the VHSs and stuff like that over there. So yeah.
If you don't rewind it back, then you get fined. All that kind of.
Yes, no, that's how it was in Blockbuster. If you don't rewind it, you get fined. My dad would yell at me all the time for not rewinding. One time I tried to swap the tapes. So what I did was I peeled like the sticker that was on the VHS, and I peeled the sticker off so I can take that wrestling tape for myself and I got busted. So.
Oh man, and if you want to tape over it, you had to get a wee bit of paper and put it into the little space, cover it in tape. Oh, I mean, I remember all the tricks. I remember all the tricks back
oh,
in
yeah,
the
of
day.
course, we all did.
Got to take the tab out if I wanted to keep Raw Rumble 2000 taped off Channel 4. It was a. These kids don't know they're born nowadays with their YouTube
Yeah,
and their
no, they
streaming.
don't know. Yeah, everything's handed to them.
Exactly. Sorry, I forgot your age, KJ. You're about the same. You're definitely younger than me, surely.
Like I'm 2000, so I'm 23. But
oh god,
born in 2000, I got like the back end of VHS going into DVD. So like I was in the crossover period. So I've got a VHS in the cupboard actually, and guaranteed every year around this time I get the flu, and I watch Friends on VHS from the beginning all the way through. So to this day, so I've not had it. Yet, touch wood, hopefully it's the first year that it doesn't happen, but I've still got my VHS. It still works.
Friends of VHS, that's a shelf.
Oh,
yeah.
Pretty much.
No, I mean, I've got back about my parents' place in their attic language, right? Attic, just to keep it easier. I've got like four massive boxes of VHS tapes from WWF from 80s to up until Unforgiven 2003. I think that's the latest one I got because I found it. I was like, VHS in 2003? Yeah, I'll have one of those. Why not? But no, that's it. You wear it out, and like I said, you can't just go onto YouTube nowadays. You can't go stream and pay whatever to watch it. You have to kind of find it and hope. If you want to watch a bit again, you'd have to just rewind it really slowly. If you missed it, oh God, it's just a whole other world that, and. I mean, I've went out to tangent. Wrestling could take a backseat for a second. VHS talk. The other thing was, I mean, for yourself, KJ, you probably would have had that weird moment where everyone tried to think of something other than DVD. So you had HD, you had with the purple band and Blu-rays, and oh man,
yeah.
What time? Anyway, wrestling. Let's talk about
wrestling. Wrestling,
so,
now.
Yeah, why not?
The Scottish VHS network.
Exactly. Oh man. Ideas for 2024 for this year for 2024. Just find VHSs and just watch them and go, oh, I think someone else cornered that market on TikTok. So 1-2-3 Kid Razor mode, so early 90s then, so big colorful characters. Was that the thing that drew you, just the larger life cartoon aspect?
Yes,
to it?
I was always transfixed on the bad guys, you know. So I was very into like the heels, like those are my guys. Like I didn't care for the Hogan and Warrior and, you know, let's go get them type of character, even though that's what I am now. But I just didn't care for them. I always liked the villain because the villain sometimes spoke with a purpose, you know, whether it was Roddy Piper, Jake the Snake Roberts, Austin before he became, you know, Stone Cold, like he was a villain. You know, when he was stunning Steve, I saw clips of that too. You know, so it was, I was always transfixed on the villain because they were larger than life to me.
Yeah, if you come in with a motive that makes sense, I mean, that's mm-hmm. for you guys watching this. Still nowadays, now the most exciting bad guys are the ones that have the motive. I mean, you think of CM Punk, probably a good example. He was beloved, and he is still to a good chunk of an audience. But he always came with a reason for doing what he was doing, why he did these things, why, and that always makes for a captivating character. Is that when you guys are wrestling, is that something you try to, when you do wrestle and you have a thing to do, you always try to band it with logic? Is that something that you guys take into account?
I would say for sure, yeah. Like, I think that, like, obviously, I come from an acting background to begin with, so I think I've always got, in the back of my head, I'm always saying, like, why is this happening? Like, why would I want to do this? Like, we had a match recently where it was pitched to us as a 2-on-1 handicap, and I was like, but why would we want to defend in a 2-on-1 handicap? Like, that's not who we are. We would want to face a team, so find them a partner. Like, make sure he finds a partner, because we as a team, our identity, we wouldn't take a 2-on-1 handicap match. So it's like one of those things where, like, there needs to be some logic there. And even like in our moveset and stuff, there's no suspending the disbelief moves. It's all very much, it's if we do this really hard, it would probably mess you up. So let's figure out a way for it to not mess up our opponent in reality. So it's one of those things where it's like, in reality, this would suck. So let's make it not suck for them to take in the world of wrestling. So there's always a reality to the stuff that we do, I feel, anyway.
Yeah, and again, is that something for yourself, Dave, when you're watching these things growing up, you've seen like IRS, for example, he's not so much motive, but he's a reason for trying to track these guys down. So as a young person watching it, that's, again, the heel motive is always something that goes, right, okay, I see why he's doing this, and it's awesome, because he's battering folk for fun, kind of thing, for a reason.
I also look at wrestling as like, I keep forgetting who does that phrase, but it's like an ice cream shop, right? There's different flavors. There has to be different flavors. You can't just have the same thing over and over again. It has to be different. You have to have some comedy aspect. You got to have some lucha aspect. You got to have some strong style aspect. It has to be, you have to have a variety, because if not, then the product just gets stale, right? People just don't want to watch it. People don't want to care for it. So if, I don't know if you've seen our match, I'm pretty sure you've seen our matches, but you know, me and KJ, our tag matches are a little bit structured differently, because we want to stand out. We want to be different. We don't do any high flying moves. That's just not something we do, because I'm not that type of Spanish guy. I can't do that. I'm sorry. That's just not my forte. So we come up with other things that make us stand out and be different, you know, and I think that's, you know, the aspect of wrestling is everybody, even with the heels, right? Like every heel was different, right? IRS, you know, Isaac Yankum, they were all different, even though they were JoJo gimmicks, but they were different. They stood out. You know, you remember Isaac Yankum. Why? Because it was such a far-fetched gimmick, right? Like a freaking evil dentist. Like, come on. IRS made me afraid of my taxes. You know, like, these are things that, as a kid, you watch, you're like, holy shit, you know, the Sultan. You know, like, all these guys, they were all different. They stood out. And I think that's what, you know, wrestling is lacking. You know, it's, you got to be different.
I certainly think in more recent years, that kind of character aspect is coming back. But like I say, it's probably not as wildly like New Gen, and there was, but there was a good period of not to say Ring of Honor was the reason, but there was a good chunk of time where it was a lot of wrestlers doing wrestling. They do good wrestling.
That's it.
And whereas you want to go, but where's the guy who's just lost his job? So he's now homeless. He's going to come and fight for every penny he can get that on the show. You know, there's a reason for it. Which I mean, as someone who's watched wrestling myself 25 years now, I think less about the actual wrestling and think about more of the story. So if you've got two guys like yourselves that are coming in and logically battering an opponent, beating them up and all that kind of stuff and taking them down, and you have a reason for it, that's more exciting to me than going, oh, he did like a 450. Oh, what happened after that? Oh, there was another 10 minutes of stuff after that. No, that should be the end. That's coming to
definitely
there.
Should, and that's one of the things that when we're training, that's what they teach us as well in the Fallout. Shout out to the Fallout Shelter. But that's one of the things that they teach us is you know, create that moment. You know, you can do the moves. Everybody can do those moves, right? Like anybody can do them. You know, you gotta practice them, and by the time you do them, you nail them. Yeah, it looks fucking great, but then what? You know, like you can only see a Canadian story so many times before you go, I've seen it already. You know, I think there was one show that I was at. I was wrestling, but I was watching. There was four Canadian destroyers in one show. Four. Like, you know, these are things that it should be discussed, I guess you can say, because you got to stand out. You got to be different. And that's why, you know, that's why I like early 90s wrestling. A lot of people aren't too big fans of it, but it was different. It was, you had different flavors, you know, and that's what drew me, was the characters. And, you know, who didn't dance like Shawn Michaels when he came out to the ring? You know what I mean? Like, you know, like, I grew my hair because of Shawn Michaels. You know, like Razor Ramon, like those guys, I grew my hair because of those guys. You know, like, you wanted to emulate those guys, you wanted to be those guys, you know, because they were different. They stood out.
So we'll fast forward a little bit the wrestling journey. So you became a fan early 90s. When did you start trying to be a wrestler? Was there a local scene for you that you could move into?
Oh, yeah, because there was a local scene, but I wasn't privy to it. I didn't know anything about independent wrestling when I first started. I just knew WWE and WCW before it went down, right? And I was in college studying criminal justice, and I was doing one of my final papers for that semester. And I was literally sitting down, you know, trying to figure out what the hell to write. And I was just like, this is not fun at all. Like, I wasn't enjoying it. I was like, what the hell I want to do in my life? I'm in college already. I tried to figure out, and then, like, I just look up, and I happen to have Monday Night Raw on. I saw the wrestling. I was just like, can I do that? I don't know, maybe. I was young. I played sports. I wasn't athletic, but I was like, I can hit the gym. So I started looking at wrestling schools, and I started searching. And then I ran across, actually, I originally was going to go to the Wild Samoans in Allentown, Pennsylvania. And, you know, I had a friend that had just moved out there. So I was like, I read Chris Jericho's book, The Lion's Tale. And I remember him saying that he slept on floors and mattresses and sofas. So I told my friend, I said, look, man, I just want to learn how to wrestle. Can I crash at your house for like 2 or 3 months? I'll get a job at McDonald's or something, and I can sleep on the floor. Because Chris Jericho did it, I'm going to do the same thing. That was my mentality.
Right.
And then, you know, my mom, you know, became ill. So I couldn't just up and leave. So the next best thing was to keep searching. And then I found the World of Unpredictable Wrestling, which was ran by Hall of Famer Johnny Rotz. Yeah. And started training there around 2009, give or take. Yeah, 2009, yeah. And I remember the week before I started training, I went to WrestleMania 24. They gave a young kid a credit card with like a $5,000 limit. So I just bought tickets to WrestleMania, bought flights, bought Universal Studios stuff. I just bought everything. And I just took a trip down there. I took a trip down there, and it was Ric Flair's last match. Watching that match, I was like, yeah, I need to be in this type of, you know, field, I guess you can say. When I got back, I just, you know, I got to work, and, you know, I trained there for about 2 years, you know, had some decent matches with a bunch of people there. And then I had to stop by choice, because I ended up having my first daughter. And then I had another one 3 years later. So I focused on being a dad and you know, being a provider. And then about 8 years after that, 8, 9 years after that, like right after the pandemic, you know, I was still a fan. I still watched the product. I still followed the product. I still bought merch and DVDs and went to the shows. I did all that. And then after me and my kid's mother split, I had a void. I needed something to do. And because I knew the promoter of Battle Club, Joe Kim, I knew he was starting up a school. So when I saw that he started up a school, I was like, who's training these guys? You know, when I saw it was a bunch of familiar faces from Johnny Rods. You know, Jorge Sante, Steve Pena, Masha Slamovich. I saw Mike, Colossal Mike Law, on an indie show, you know, a few years after I had stopped wrestling. So I've seen these guys. I know these guys, you know, most of them. So I tried to, you know, I reached out and I tried, and it was like, you know, just come for a day. came for a day, did a few drills. It was good. I felt good. And then KJ remembers this, Santana from Pride of Powerful came in one day to train with us, and he fucking destroyed us. He did one of the most insane drills I ever done. And, people were throwing up, and it was fucking great. But I held my own. I didn't throw up, and I was just like, yeah, I'm back. And I gave him the money to sign up, and I joined back, back into the wrestling fold.
I'm just bringing into this is KJ. This is kind of where you guys would have crossed paths then for the first time. I assume that would be the case. Mm-hmm. Would have been a pretty young kid at this point, even younger than you are now. So coming in and seeing someone like a Dave who did it for a little bit and had to take that big extended break was he a guy that you'd probably look to go, right, okay, he's probably got a little bit of additional knowledge that maybe my traders may not have because he's taking that big break. Was he a guy you gravitated towards?
I was like, when Dave first came in, I think I'd only been there maybe a couple months because I started with Fallout in the August, and I think Dave came in October. And I just, he knew all the coaches when he first arrived, so I just presumed, because I hadn't been there long, I just presumed he was someone that had worked with them for a long time, and like was this experienced head that was coming in as like another coach or something, I don't know, because he knew everyone. So I was like, right, okay, cool. So I thought he'd been doing it a while, I didn't know about the break and stuff, so, I was always kind of the first person to get to know people that were new into Fallout, because I was there, like there was an established school there by the time I arrived, so I was there, so I made a point of anyone that was coming in, I was wanting to get to know them and kind of get on and stuff. And then I found that me and David, we very, very quickly got on, just like laughing and joking and stuff whilst we put the work in, but like we always found time to have a bit of a laugh and a joke with other coaches and stuff as well. So I think we very quickly gravitated toward each other. And then that was when we started doing Advanced Wednesdays, which was just basically practice matches and stuff. And they were frequently putting us together just to kind of give match experience to kind of less experienced guys in a format that they were capable of, putting them in a tag match with two more experienced guys, and then we can figure something out. Mm-hmm. And it just kind of went from there and kind of grew from there, where we just started teaming every Wednesday at the advanced sessions. And then obviously when the time came, we needed a team for one of the shows, it ended up being us.
Oh, wait, you skipped one part.
A little bit.
Yeah. So, I was goofing around. This is where the Scotaricans name came from. It was, I just thought he was placating like Scottishmen. And I was just like he was breaking down to me like his school schedule and like the, when he has to go back to Scotland and blah, blah, blah. So we're joking around and I was just like, yeah. I said, when we become a tag team, like joking around, I was like, they'll just call us the Scotaricans. So he popped, yeah. I laughed. And then like, I went to go use the restroom. And I was talking to Joakim, the promoter, and I was like, yo, if you ever want, a tag team, me and KJ are called the Scotaricans now, so you can just, he popped, like, he laughed so freaking hard. So he's like, that's interesting. And then, like, later on that night, he went on the Battle Club website and just put a Scottish flag and a Puerto Rican flag and said absolutely nothing. And he just left us in the know, like, not knowing what the hell he was doing. So, I told KJ, I said, he might be doing something with this, because why would he put that on the Battle Club site if he wasn't, like, serious about it? Mm-hmm. On the Twitter, I believe, before it was X. Yeah. And literally, a few months later, I got the call. He was like, yo, try to get same gear as KJ. You Scotaricans are going up. And I was like, what? And our first match was a tag team title match. And it was against three other experienced tag teams. So that was like a culture shock for both of us. But I believe we did good and we did what we were supposed to do, and you know, and they noticed it. So,
especially when
that was a good thing.
Guys would have met. It would have been again not just like the generation of wrestling you would have got to know, because this is KJ's early 2000 onwards, and for yourself, Dave, it's 90s onwards. But there's also the kind of culture shock as well between yourself, KJ, Scotland. So you know,
yeah,
we know what Scotland's like. And yourself, Dave. It just seems like a bit of an odd couple kind of meshing together.
Yeah,
that seems to have just blossomed quite nicely.
And that's the thing, right? The running joke is we never say who's Scottish and who's Puerto Rican. You know, we leave that up to your interpretation. You know, even though it's clear, we leave it up to your interpretation. So sometimes we say KJ is Puerto Rican, I'm sort of Scottish. So it's like, you know.
the best of that there is like the context of them referring to me as Puerto Rican in America. It goes over their heads why I find that so funny, just being referred to as Puerto Rican. I'm like, hey, I shower daily. I don't know what you're talking about. And no one gets it. Had to explain it a million times, but it cracks me up every time. But no, like that was one of those things where when we got together, like the top team in WWE was RK-Bro. And like odd couple tag teams were kind of the thing for a while in WWE at that point, where they were just kind of throwing people together. And we thought, like, let's kind of play off of that and try get that kind of that odd couple dynamic. Like, we know that we get on great and that we mesh really well, but the crowd doesn't need to know that. So we kind of played off of that for the first kind of couple months, and then it just became very evident to everyone that we mesh very well and that we've got good chemistry.
I believe RK-Bro was only that long ago. That's the years of wrestling have gone by too fast, I think, and
yeah,
my brains. But yeah, that whole meshing, at least it wasn't like the late 2000s where you got team whatever, team Hell No, team
yeah,
Rhodes,
yeah.
Scholars. At least you're not team Scotaricans, you're just
team
Scottish.
Something, yeah.
Oh god, that was a time we
the team
need.
Name
but so as far as then, you realize you guys are meshing well, you've kind of got a bit of a rhythm going on behind the scenes and in the training and what have you. Is there anything that you go, right, I need to study this tag team, that tag team, or is it a case of you just bouncing off general ideas to make yourself kind of a different flavor from the rest? Go back to the ice cream analogy.
Well, I think for me anyway, we first started working together kind of early part of 2022.
Yeah.
And then obviously I came home for the summer. So it was a long stretch where we weren't together. I was here, Dave was over there, we were doing our own thing. And that was the first time I come onto the pod. I did my stuff with Girders, I did my stuff with Pro 2, we did the single stuff. But when we really kind of kicked into a different gear and really became like the tag team, was when I first went back that weekend. We then had a match at Battle Club against the Main Event, who are, as far as I'm aware, still MLW Tag Team Champions.
No, they're Hog.
Hog, not MLW. Damn. House of Glory.
Shout out to those guys.
Yeah, for sure. Because we come back and we had that match, and it really, because in that area and that sphere, they are like the pinnacle tag team, I think. In my opinion, they still are. Like those are the guys to beat, and at the time they literally were for us because they had the Battle Club tag titles. And we went and we worked with those guys. We'd known them for a while because they were in that first match that we were in. But we got that kind of team on team, like regular tag team match, just the four of us. And that was really where we got given this format for a tag match, where it was like, here's the format, here's how the matches run, slot in your stuff here, here, and here. And we've taken that and ran with it because it was different. And they were like, this is how you guys need to go and move forward with tag team wrestling. Like, not everything has to be team move, team move, team move, team move. It can be two singles matches that cross over at times.
Mm-hmm.
And that really kind of changed my perspective. I don't know, Dave, about you personally, but like for me, that changed my perspective on tag wrestling, because I always viewed it as like growing up, the, when I was growing up, I had an era of like the kind of DX comeback and Evolution. And like those were the kind of top teams at the time. And for me watching them, it was always about like they're a team, they're doing their team thing against this other team. And I'd never really considered the prospect of these are two teams, but they're still two individuals, like in each team. So it can be two singles matches that happen to cross over.
Yeah.
And these intersections is where the interesting things happen. And I really, that really changed my perspective once we had that match, because I think it kicked us up into an extra gear that we didn't know we had. And we've just been climbing since.
Yeah, I agree. I think working those two upped our game, you know, as far as like how we look at any match. And it also gave us that bit of confidence that I feel like we were sort of lacking. And also it gave us the confidence within the fans too, right? Because, you know, they see that this young team is keeping up with these, you know, these guys that are been around for a good amount of time and are considered one of the best tag teams in the East Coast. You know, so we're keeping up with those guys, and that's, you know, boosting our credit up, and that's boosting our stock. You know, so, you know, calling those matches and how, you know, calling that match and just listening, because, you know, a lot of people, they tend to not listen. But, like, you know, these guys are, you know, they're sort of, they're younger than me, but they're the vets, right? So I'm listening to what they're saying because they know more than I do, you know, and I have no shame in being quiet and listening, right? And a lot of people have that problem where they don't listen because they think they know it all. I'm not one of those guys. I listen. If you've been around the block more than me, I'm going to listen to you. I'm going to listen to what you're saying. And if I disagree, I'll say, hey, can we do something else? Like, I'll come up with something else that benefits everybody. You know, that's one thing that I, you know, we were talking to this match, and like, it was literally, I would say, oh, can we do this? And it was like, oh, that's great, let's do this. And it was just like, we were going back and forth, and it was, they were open to our ideas. They just didn't dismiss us like some tag teams would do or have them. You know, it's literally just, hey, you know, that's cool, but what if we did it this way, right? And what if we did it that way, Sid? They gave you a perspective on not being so confrontational when it comes to like working a match, but understanding this is the point that needs to be come up, put across, and this is how we're going to do it, and this is how we're going to make it work. And then at the end of the day, it was, to me, so far, it's been our best match since. And we do intend to run it back with those guys, because we got something that they want. So,
of course, we'll definitely get onto that. But still on that kind of subject, I suppose when it comes to tag team wrestling, I mean, during the pandemic, I watched a seminar with Krieger from Glasgow Grindhouse with Looping Sharp.
Yep.
And it changed my perspective on tag team wrestling entirely, because they came in pretty much saying that the wrestling, that's secondary. If you abide by these rules, but if you keep the structure of the tag rope, the distraction, the corner, if you keep that kind of in line, the rest of it just falls into place after that. So it just, since watching that, listening to it, then watching tag team wrestling, it just gives you a new appreciation of going, okay, they've done this because of that. And they've done this because of that. That's why that works. And it just makes matches more enjoyable. Then you know when they fuck up, though. And then you watch it and go, ah, no, they've went wrong here somewhere.
Yeah.
Which, so double-edged sword in that respect. Or you can watch it and go, yeah, that looks
for
good.
Sure.
And I'm watching going, ah, no, they fucked this. This is awful. But, you know, one of those things. But of course, yeah, we'll speak. Actually, before we speak about the, you know, the big thing that happened last year, I'll get it right eventually. I've got no more recordings this year. I'll be fine. I mean, oh, God. Right. So It's bringing in Jordy Lee. So Jordy Effin Lee should. That's the full Christian name there.
Yeah, for sure.
So how did they come on board?
You want to take
that? We knew that we would need somebody to accompany us, just to give us that, you know, that extra oomph, you know. And you know, there was an opportunity that was presented to Jordy where she would be in a Battle Club show. And I was just like, well, if she's going to be in the show, maybe she should come manage us, because we had gotten along already. You know, she was always cool with us. And I said, hey, do you want to, you know, just come out with us and see what happens and see if it works. And then before you know it, every time we come out, that's who they expect to come out with us. And, you know, Jordy is one of the sweetest girls you'll ever meet. And she just fit well with what we were presenting. And she was the little firecracker that lit the fuse for us, you know. So that was what I wanted. It was, you know, that one more piece to just make it. And it's not necessarily, she wasn't a manager. You know, we wanted her to be a part of the Scotaricans. It wasn't, because we didn't want the manager valet thing, because she can kick ass. She's a tough girl. So we wanted her to be a part of it, so that it kind of was like, I guess, another version of the Freebirds, right? Where, you know, and there was times where we had tag matches and KJ wasn't around and Jordy tagged with me. So it was, you know, it was one of those things that worked. So that's why we brought her on, was because we just needed that one little oomph to boost up the, I guess, the stock of the Scotaricans.
And I suppose for KJ as well, because you do have to go come back to Scotland and do studies and what have you. It like you're saying, it keeps the tag team kind of around and ongoing for shows that you can't get to. Do you find that's, I don't know if it, now you've finished up college, is we're now into 2024. Do you find that's, this is now your next year kind of thing? Now you've got a little bit more stability in the US, you can properly get Scotaricans going. Whereas before you could, but you had to go away every couple of months and maybe lose a bit of momentum here or there. But you had Jordy to fill the void.
Yeah, for sure. Like for me personally, like I found it that it was great that we weren't completely dormant when I was away. It was frustrating for me individually, like for my own development, where I was like, yep, momentum, momentum, momentum. Ah, I need to go away for 3 months. Momentum, momentum, momentum. Oh, I'm away for another month. Like it was one of these things where it was getting to a point where it felt like I was getting bogged down by injuries without getting injured. Like it was that kind of feeling where it was like, you see a lot of these stories where people's getting a lot of momentum. They're up in the kind of the upper tier of people's minds when it comes to a certain category. Like we've just seen it with like Charlotte. She's out for another 9 months after getting injured, where she was getting pushed back into the top again. And that's kind of what it felt like for a little bit, because it felt like as a team we were getting some great momentum and we were doing some great things, but then I had to go home and I would maybe do a couple of singles matches whilst I was at home, and it was really disconnected. So I was happy that Jordy was able to step in so that Scotaricans as a team were still going, even if I couldn't be there. Because it definitely kept us in the minds of everyone, especially people that were coming to Battle Club shows, because there was for a long while there, before we kind of went on a little hiatus as a company, there was a while there where it was just expected the Scotaricans were going to be there on a show. Like, people would come with the t-shirts, they'd come with flags sometimes, even just expecting us to be there, even if we hadn't been announced, because the chances were we were going to show up somewhere on the card. So I think now that I've graduated and we can, like, one thing we've been wanting to do for a long time is Wrestle Open, but because it's up in Massachusetts and we were obviously down in New York, it wasn't ideal for us to get up there, because it's such a long drive and it's on a Thursday And I would some although I wouldn't have class on a Friday, I would have class on a Thursday, and we wouldn't have enough time to get up. But that's something now that's a possibility because I now no longer have class. And if I was to pick up a job, I can put a day in saying, look, Thursday I can't be here, I'm off. And that's now a possibility, and it opens up new doors for us that weren't available before. And that's something I'm really looking forward to. Because something we said at the very beginning of the Scotaricans is that, like, if we're going to do anything, we're going to do it together. Like, if we get an opportunity, it's because we've all worked for it, and it's not going to be like no one's slacking because we all work hard, and we've all been rewarded for it since. So I'm excited now that I've graduated just to have that, as you said, extra oomph and those extra opportunities that weren't available to us before, because of my time frames.
So I mean, considering that 2023 was almost a stop start as opposed to your studies and what have you, you guys still in April 2023 became the Battle Club Pro Tag Team Champions. I was looking at the card for Anti-Up when I was doing my research there, and I was like, how did this happen? Because you guys were in a title match, then I was seeing the next post like, oh, hang on, you guys are the champion. So explain it a little bit to me, for those that are unaware, and then yeah, talk about you becoming champions.
It's well, it was a perfect example of how the Scotaricans are a three-person team. Because in the opening match of the night, we faced off against Prolific, a rematch from that very, very first match we ever had. They were the last team of the other three teams that we hadn't faced yet. So we had our match against Prolific. We pulled off the win. We then went backstage, and later on in the night, there was a battle royal. And
Yeah, it's the
it's
best
the
way to
simplest way
describe
to put it. Yeah, it's the best way to describe it. It's a concept that Battle Club have called Survival of the Fittest. It's ultimately a battle royal, is the simplest way to
Okay.
put it. There's a whole bunch of caveats to that, but at the end of the day, it's a battle royal. However, if you win Survival of the Fittest, you get your essentially money in the bank
Right.
briefcase. You can cash in any time on any champion you want. Now, to our knowledge, like shoot, to our knowledge, someone else was winning that match. I think off the top of my head, it was maybe Ahmed,
It was Ahmed,
or
from what
it was
I remember.
Ahmed. Yeah, from what I remember, Ahmed was winning that match, and so we thought we were done for the evening. I think actually, like before that match, I had gone to McDonald's and got my dinner. Like we were done. As far as we were concerned, and we came back, and during the intermission, we were told, "Oh, by the way, in the tag title match, main event, Federated." And I spoke about Federated the last time I was on. We were feuding with Federated pretty hard, particularly Jordy against Abe Khan. So we were feuding pretty hard. So all we were told was, in the tag team title match, main event versus Federated. Main event just want you guys to go out there as security, essentially. They want you to lumberjack the match, make sure no other members of Federated get involved. Great, fantastic. So at this point, we don't know what's going on in the Survival of the Fittest match. We've been taken away to go through the tag match and get our details for what was happening there. So little to our knowledge, actually Jordy won the Survival of the Fittest match. Which we weren't aware of. We'd been faked out. So we went out with no knowledge of this, to help out main event and their tag title match against Federated to try regain their Battle Club tag titles. Federated ultimately got themselves disqualified. So we, because they were being cowardly, we put the beats on Federated after the match. And lo and behold, here appears Jordy Lee with a contract saying she gets a tag title match. Well, not necessarily a tag title match. She gets a title match anytime, any place for any title. And she decides she's cashing in for the three of us on the tag team titles. And in that moment, that is when we found out that we were winning the tag team titles. We didn't know.
Wow. I can't imagine that kind of pressure being flung on you right that second as you stand there thinking, this is just the end of the show. Oh no.
Goosebumps.
Yeah. Because all we got told by Main Event where you guys
are going to wrestle them down the road.
Yeah. You guys are going to wrestle them on the anniversary, which is October. Battle Club's anniversary is October. You guys are going to wrestle them in October. You need to act like champions between now and then. You need to be locker room leaders, all that jazz. We got this big talk for further down the line. But they gave us a big speech. They were prepping us for way down the line because this is April. And we were prepared for that. We're like, right, okay, cool, we get it. That's awesome. Thank you. We appreciate this talk. And they just said to us, look, in the match, all you need to do is defend us from any federated members, and then when the time comes, we're going to tell you to hit your finish on Rembrandt, who's a member of Federated, who was in the match, one of the tag champions at the time. Is that when we give you the go, just hit your finish on Rembrandt, and then we can all cheer in front of the crowd, and it'll be great. Well, okay, cool. So we're just waiting on our cue, and then Jordy comes running out with the contract, and Midas grabs me by the collar and says, yo, by the way, when we said hit your finisher, this is the time. You're going to hit your finisher right now. You guys are winning the titles now. And there's a clip on my Instagram. There's a clip on the Battle Club Instagram. I don't know if you've got it, Dave, where you see the utter confusion of why Jordy's there. And then the realization of, we were so confused. And we then get the realization of, Oh shit. So like now, okay, great, okay, yep, finisher, go. Ah, and that, like, that moment. And everyone in the match, including Jordy, was in on it, apart from us. We had no idea.
The ref, so the ref didn't out. Even know until before he came out.
Yeah. Yeah.
Nobody knew. None of the boys in the back knew. Some of the coaches knew. Other than that,
yeah, like my girlfriend to this day still holds a grudge against Joe, the owner of Battle Club, for not even telling her, because that evening she was doing the backstage interviews, so she was all dolled up interviewing everyone backstage, and she didn't know that we were doing the stuff with Main Event. So she was just doing her job, and then she heard a commotion outside, and her friend tapped her and go, oh, by the way, your boyfriend's just won the titles. She's like, what? So he's just won the titles. And she was like, no, he hasn't. And then she looked outside, and there we were with the titles. She was mad at me for not telling her. I was like, I didn't know. How was I supposed to know? So she's still mad at Joe for not even cluing her in. It's like, not even telling her that we were winning, just to clue her in to maybe go outside. But so she still holds that grudge. But apart from that, it was it was great.
It's funny, right? It's funny. Like, Joe was giving hints to me, because at that show I had my hair out. Like, I didn't get a braid or anything like that. And he was like, "Yo, maybe try to like shape yourself up and stuff like that." Like, he was giving hints, and he's like, "Is there any way your kids could come?" And I'm just like, "Well, no, I don't got anybody to watch them." You know, like, I usually have my best friend there. So like, I didn't, like, he was giving hints as to like, you know, maybe you should have your family here, but he wasn't directly saying it. So like, he was pretty much like indirect, like, yo, listen, this is what's gonna happen, but I can't physically tell you. So like, I should have paid attention to it. But
like, the guys all night trying to keep us in our gear. Like, we were, after our match, we were so gonna get annoyed. Changed.
Oh my god!
So we were trying to get changed all night, like, because for the main event match, We were going to go out and like track pants and a t-shirt and a hoodie. Like, we were security. That's all we needed. We didn't need to be in gear. And they were like, no, you are staying in gear. And I was like, why? Why can't we just get changed? Like, no, stay in gear. It looks more professional. And we're like, what? Really? Like, we're just secure. We're just hanging out. And they would stay in gear. The whole night we were trying to get changed. They wouldn't let us. And then obviously we found out why in the end.
Kept getting yelled at. That's exactly what happened. They was like, nope, then you fucking gear. I was like, God damn it. And KJ knows I hate being in gear. Like,
yes.
The second I could take my gear off, I'm like, all right, let's do this. If I'm not wrestling, I don't want to be in my gear.
You're an open a match guy. Is it sooner get it on, sooner get it off?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Listen, we pilot, well, I don't want to say pilot, but we request that we are opening up the show solely because I just want to get it over with. You know what I mean? We're the standard bearer for the show. So whatever, no matter what we do, it's going to be entertaining. So go through the show, and then after that, we're good after that, right? We can hang out. We can sell our merch. We can bullshit with the boys. The pressure's off you. And then I can eat. Like, I like to eat, and I don't eat the day before the show. Like, during the show, right. I don't eat. I just drink water. I just hydrate myself. Because I just want to get the show over with, so...
I think, KJ, you'll know Beatty Gunn. I think I remember an interview he did, and it was like he never wanted to be main event champion again because he didn't like it was past his bedtime. He didn't want to stay.
Yep. He didn't like being last on. It was like, ah, bugger that. That's where the same, like that night, because they told us to stay in gear, like I'm standing at McDonald's in my gear, like waiting on a bloody meal coming. People are like, what the hell is. I ran down to McDonald's in my ring boots and everything. I'm like, what the hell?
Mm-hmm.
But that's we like being on first. We like setting the standard for the show. We like setting the tone for the show. We like being on first, and if it has to happen, we don't mind going on last. But it's that middle that middle ground, like either side of intermission, we try and avoid.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean that's bad, like. Just an absolute wild night. So you didn't really have time to worry about it or think about it. And then, of course, you mentioned that a lot of guys come to Battle Club maybe just to see the Scotaricans with the gear and that. So they've got a little bit of a bonus payoff at the same time where they're sitting there going, oh my God, the guys that we've come to see for the last year are now the champions. So must for both of you as well, because Dave, you said you'd had that massive break and you had kids and what have you. And for you, KJ, that you're just a kid from Scotland coming over to the US, the American dream, so to speak.
Yep.
It must be just when did it really sink in that what had happened and the historic nature for yourself that you were champions?
I think,
me, when they passed me the title.
Instant.
Right, but it's still, like, it was like a surreal moment. Like, I had to, like, literally after we, like, got through the curtain, like, all the boys just taking us and all this other stuff, hugging us. Like, and I had to, like, go to, like, a corner and just, like, sit and, like, process it all. Because we wasn't expecting any of this, right? We were expecting just having a normal tag team match and just climbing up the ladder to get to where we ended up getting to the later on that day. But it wasn't like we knew it was going to happen. I wish we were more prepared, but we did what we had to do. And that was one of the things that I loved about it was a surreal moment, like the hugs and, you know, the tears and what you saw from me and KJ and Jordy, like that was legit, you know, that was legit feelings, you know, and I needed that because I wasn't too happy with my performance the match, you know, earlier that day. And then, you know, so it was one of those things where, like, I was just, let's get this over with and keep it moving. Like, that was my mindset. It was like, let's just hit whoever we're going to hit with the finishing call of the day. Little did I know that what we were going to hit would have been, like, you know, us winning the titles. But this is something that I had in my mind where I was like, you know, let's just get it over with. But then when it happened, I didn't want it to be over. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It was just like, that was, and then like the embracing, like the hug of, you know, Joe Kim, like right before we went through the curtain was like, that was something that I will always cherish because it was a moment. You know, and like I said earlier, you know, create moments.
Absolutely. Yep. Absolutely. I'm sorry for you. You did put out, KJ, you put out a post probably the day of or day after ish kind of about it, and it really, when I read it back, it was just like that's a guy that's can't believe that he's got a title, especially there.
It was one of those things where, like, I think title wise and like booking wise as well, I think they've been holding it back from us, but we were getting like quite like antsy because we were having a tournament the following month for the Fallout Championship, so the our effectively our NXT title, like we were going to have a tournament to crown the first champion and all that, and I was told I wasn't going to be in the tournament, and I was like, why the hell am I not going to be in it? That's crazy. Like, what? I was so frustrated, and then obviously I found out why I wasn't going to be in it. But it was like one of those things where just it was dropped on us, because I think even the booking decision was even the booking decision itself was rather last minute. Injuries and stuff happening to people and like all that, it was last minute, and it was just something that I didn't expect at all. And like it's one of these things where like people that don't get it, they don't, like, they're not in the sphere of wrestling. Like all the people that you meet that are like, oh, it's just fake, isn't it? Like they don't get it, because like there can be such a natural moment as that where even in the people in the ring don't know. And because the title isn't, like, it's not a title in like boxing where it's a recognition of you are the best in the world at that sport. A title in wrestling is recognition of hard work and respect of your peers, which meant the most to me. Because like you said, you read back that post, and like like the picture that I didn't put in that post, it's a picture that my girlfriend took the next morning. I was just sitting there staring at the title the next morning, like, because I was still in disbelief. And it's one of those things where that post, I've went down the list, and I was like, literally every single coach that ever got in a ring with me and taught me anything got a thank you, got a mention, because those are the people that got us that moment. Because like even from the beginning, if it wasn't for Wolfie and Stevie Boy and BT Gunn, and like if those guys didn't give me that base that I got here before I even moved to America, I'm not at a good enough standard to be one of the guys that is entrusted with something like last minute forming a team and then that team to then be trusted to do X, Y, and Z, to then be trusted again when things didn't work in the division. Like it's one of those things where like that's what struck me most, I think, was the that is a sign of recognition, of respect and hard work. And that's what meant the most to me.
Now, be honest, guys.
Yeah, it's
how long did you wear it the next day? How were you wearing the title belts the whole all next day? I mean, I would if I won a title.
So KJ, so I made sure my daughter saw the belt. So because like they weren't there, and that's one thing that like I went back to wrestling so my daughters could watch wrestling. And KJ can tell you, my oldest is, you know, very calm, collected child, but the little one will be a future wrestler. I can almost guarantee you that.
Yeah,
she has that charisma, and she's the life of the locker room. She's the life of backstage. If you let her talk to you, she'll talk your ear off. And she's witty. Like, she's very witty. So I wanted her to see it. And she has a running joke with Abe Khan where, you know, she doesn't like Abe Khan at all. Like, she hates him. So I showed her the tag titles. And the first thing she said was, isn't this the title Abe Khan had? I said, yes. And she was like, I need you to record a video and send it to him. And it's literally her going, aha, Abe, my dad took your title, aha. And Abe popped. He was like, that's the best thing I've ever seen in my life.
That's amazing. So
it's one of those things. I always tell people, it's a, you know, so that first day, yeah, I brought it with me just so that my kids can see. And then, yeah, happened to. I didn't walk around with it though, because it was just. I was also sort of like still in disbelief. You know what I mean? Like, I had the title. It was just like there. It was like, it's there. Like, I have a title. It's pretty cool. You know, you dream of that when you're younger, right? Like, it's like, and you want to be a wrestler. You're like, oh, I can't wait for they put the title around me. And, like, raise my hand with the belt and like the whole hand. No, you know, that's something you always wanted to hear when you're training to be a wrestler, and then you get it. And it's not because you sold tickets, because you earned it. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
You know, because it, you know, there's people that win titles because, you know, they sold the most tickets. That's just how it is. You know, I was one of those guys that did when I first started, you know, and I felt like this was actually a title I earned.
Absolutely.
You know.
I mean, I noted down for a moment, you had that euphoria of winning titles, and then KJ, you've kind of scared me a bit, because I do have it written down next is you were fighting each other in the Fallout Shelter Championship tournament.
That was
yeah, we did.
But
we went
did.
into
good,
uh,
good, that's fine.
Yeah, 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 we did. We went into taping season, and we taped a whole season of Battle Club X, which is the YouTube show that was kind of going up weekly. And we got a bunch of defenses in. But one of those was we drew the names for the Fallout title tournament. Of course, we faced each other, but we were able to put on a great match that was just based solely on technical ability and trying to outwit each other. There was not a single strike thrown. It was fantastic, and in my opinion, how a 5-minute TV match between two friends should go. And I was so proud of the match that I think a lot of stuff where people have asked to be sent stuff, that's one of the matches I send, because I think it was two people with great chemistry, obviously as a tag team, having never faced each other. But because I knew everything Dave was good at, Dave knew everything I was good at, we just went and kind of had a lot of fun with it.
Mm-hmm. So, and you get to do maybe something you don't get to do in other matches, anything. You get to have a little bit of fun. You don't have to be, you're not out to look like you're going to destroy someone. You're looking just to outwit, like saying, outwit the other to get into the next round, which that's a great concept.
It was all out of respect. You know, like, I respect him, you know, tremendously. So when the idea of the match was presented, you know, when it was selected, I was just like, yeah, let's do this. And I had a mindset, he had a mindset, and we just went with it. And we weren't told, you know, no restrictions, we weren't told anything. And we could have went longer if we wanted to, because we could have been like, we want to go longer. But, you know, we felt like in 5 minutes we can tell the story of him and I and what we can and cannot do.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
And I think that was the main thing. Like, as soon as it came out the hat that it was going to be me and Dave, the first thing I said, I turned to him, I was like, Brett Bulldog at Wembley.
Right.
But
right.
That was the first thing I was, and if you watch the match back, that's exactly how it ends. I go for a sunset flip, and he catches my legs and pins me. Like, that was the first thing. The first thing that came to mind as soon as it was confirmed that was the match, I was like, Brett Bulldog at Wembley. That's what it has to be. Like, we've not got 90,000 people, and we've not got a half hour. We've got 5 minutes, and we've got 10 people who are in for a closed door taping. But I want to get that exact same message across, and I think we achieved that.
And that'd be great. So, looking forward, then, that was middle of the year. So that was the middle of last year. But yep. I'll get it right. It was middle of last year. So a lot of 6 months, sorry, 7 months time, and all that kind of stuff. Defenses in, you're getting a more of a rhythm now. Like, say into 2024, you guys are going to be a bit more, together and being able to maybe expand to go into other companies, like you have recently, as well. Is there is there any thoughts? I mean, for yourself, KJ, especially, are you keeping an eye on the scene over in Scotland, thinking, oh, there's a couple of tag teams I wouldn't mind getting Dave over for, and can do some good stuff for Iron Girders or for Pro 2 or for whomever with the Battle Club Pro tag titles online. Who you got your eye on?
So it was something that was unfortunate over the summer. We actually did have a couple lined up, and then it just kind of fell through just because of scheduling. But the ones that I really want personally are ones with guys that I came up with in the early days of Iron Girders. So like Arcade Violence is the main one that I want, because I came up with those two all the way through. Like once restrictions allowed us to train with other people, like it was kind of the three of us trained a lot together. And then obviously I went away, they formed a tag team, and then when I came back, they were kind of some of the top guys. So that was something that I was really wanting to get done. Casino Brutale, another one. KOE, but obviously the injury meant that that couldn't happen. There was a lot that I was thinking, and obviously Glasgow Grindhouse would be another one because I've trained a lot with Luke Kingsharp. And when you're in America and you're looking back into the kind of Scottish scene, and mainly with Girders, because like in my opinion, I think Girders is leading the way just now of how like a smaller indie company should be run, like anywhere in the world. And I think they've perfected a science, and they're smashing it out of the park every time. So that's something that I watch, and I see the kind of tag teams coming through that are frequenting those shows. And then I'm like, right, cool. Here's the defense against them. Here's how it would go. Here's how we would book it. We would do this, and then they would do this to us. And this is how we work around it. And I get really excited about it. And I'm like, oh yeah, it's like 6 months till I go back, and then if I go back, we need to line it up with you coming over, and then they need to be fit and ready, and it was a pain, especially this summer, because there was a couple lined up that just ended up not coming through because of scheduling and cause of injury. But like the dream is to actually get like a multiple match series. Like my perfect scenario is to have Arcade Violence over in New York and then have us in Glasgow and do both, because I think that is a match that would go into that kind of top tier of our match main event. Like I think that would be the level with those guys.
Yeah, I mean, and then you could say that you can make those tag titles world tag titles because you've defended it worldwide. You know, and again, that's
For
another
sure.
historic moment for the both of you. And for yourself, Dave, has KJ been pushing these teams on you, or is there any teams out there that you're keeping an eye on for defenses?
Okay, I'm selfishly going to say this, and I say this every podcast that we're in. I want us to work the revival, because they're just, to me, the top tag team out today, and I feel like wrestling those guys will not only up our stock, but it will also up our knowledge in tag team wrestling. Because those guys know so much. So the idea for us is to learn as much as we can from them. But if we're doing like independent circuit, I want to work a team. Can you guys hear me? I'm sorry.
Yep, yeah,
It's
you're fine.
just, I don't know. Yeah. I want to work a team from the independent circuit. They're former wrestlers from Chikara. They're called the Batiri. Those are guys that I, similar to KJ, trained with numerous times and numerous, good amount of 2 years I trained with those guys. And they're another tag team that I would love to just get in the ring with. And that's a tag team that I know next year will happen. I've been given the green light that it will happen. I just don't know what date exactly, but it will happen. We will work those two guys. I know KJ's been you know, wanting this Grizzly Young Vets. Those guys are just phenomenal tag team. You know, they're on the independent circuit, so now it's just a matter of waiting for the stars to align, so that we can get our hands on them and we can work some magic with those guys. So that's one thing that I want to do, and hopefully, you know, like I said, if the stars align, that's another tag team that I want to get in there with. There's another one that I want, hopefully, if it can happen, I want that match with Federated, an actual match with Federated, with main event Mermbent and Abe Khan, because I feel like there's still, we need to finish, I guess, the story, but we need that one match. We haven't had that match yet, where it's a normal tag team match where we go balls to the wall and we figure out, you know, who's the better team, you know, and that's one of those things where, like, I want that to happen. Fingers crossed it does happen, but, you know, there's a few teams to, you know, throw out there. And then the other tag team that wants to smoke, so.
There you go.
So we did get one, we got a question through the Instagram, which I'm just going to find, although I think now that I know the context of everything, I think I understand why it's been asked. It is just for yourself, KJ. It's from Gabriella has sent us, ask KJ if he's single, and if so, is he interested in a cute American girl?
She's bloody ridiculous. She's sitting there laughing at me. Aye, she's no, I'm not single. I'm taken by Gabriella. She's sitting there a little laughing.
But yeah, KJ, blink twice if you're in danger. Okay, I'll send the authorities.
What a way to end the show here. So it looks like we're into 2024 is going to be a huge year for the Scotaricans, and I'm sure I'll definitely be keeping an eye on it a bit closer than I admittedly have done the last wee while. But, you know, much like Dave, I've got a child now, so things take priority. So it's trying to keep up to date with stuff is the hardest thing in the world. So where can people find out more about yourselves if they want to find out more about either the Scott half, of course, Dave, and the Rishan half of KJ?
So for me, you can find me on my Instagram and David We Trust. On my X, it's the Dave Rivera and David We Trust was taken. So that's where you can find me on social media. We're working on some new merch coming out soon, as well as a booking email. So anybody that wants to book us, we just one straight email, and working, you know, I'm coordinating that with KJ now. So that's where you can find me.
Yourself.
Yep. And then for me, it is KJ Mack Wrestling on Instagram, KJ Mack Wrestler on X, and for the time being, till we set up the Scott Rican email, KJ Mack Wrestling @gmail.com is the email to get us. And whilst you're there, follow the Fallout Shelter, follow Battle Club Pro.
Yes. Also, shout out to the Fallout Shelter, all the coaches, Steve Pena, Colossal Mike Law, Masha Slambovich, Jorge Santi, Prince Ahmed, and Akira. There's a lot of coaches. There's a lot of young talent out there that are in the up and coming. So, you know, watch out for those guys too.
And let's not forget, get following Jordy F and Lee as well. Jordy, if you're following these two guys.
I was going to leave like a best to last thing for her, but like, yeah, like when she, I think our Instagram is deactivated at the moment, but when she reactivates it,
it's back on.
There we go. So we can follow Jordy Lee again. Because if it wasn't for her, we would not be tag team champions.
There you go.
Yes. Thank you, Jordy. Well, also, one more shout out to, you know, one of the coolest guys in the the fallout. He makes sure that any type of moves we do are seen and are put in the nicest gifts you can think is our boy Jokoi, aka the gift god. Follow him. He's one of the coolest guys you'll ever meet in the wrestling industry. And should I give him a shout out? Because that's one of my brothers right there.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much for the time difference. We've got a chat in just before in January of 2024. This has been
we almost had it.
Almost. Oh, yes, God. Exactly. I can't wait. Next recording I do is in January, and I can't wait because I don't have to panic every time I say the year. But no, this has been a great chat. Thank you very much for joining me. And look forward to see what you guys do in 2024.
Thanks. Yeah, cheers. Thanks for having us on.